Welcome back. Our special focus now on the news today. We are shifting focus to Washington, D.C. and going straight live because Donald Trump is set to take oath as America's 45th and, dare I say, oldest president shortly. He's also America's richest president and maybe the most controversial, particularly given the way he's chosen his cabinet and the various statements he's made in the 8 weeks since he won that famous victory in November this year. Donald Trump, the president-elect of America, is set to become the president of America. That's right. Those are the images. There you can see Donald Trump with the outgoing president, Barack Obama. Two people who've had serious ideological differences, but on a day like this, they present a sense of the unity of red and blue in American democracy.
Hello, everybody.
Barack Obama and Donald Trump on their way to the swearing-in of the U.S. president. The 45th president of the United States will be Donald Trump. We're going to have correspondents in different parts of the world who are joining us. My colleague Smita Sharma, diplomatic editor, will also be with me here in the studio to give me various details of the inauguration ceremony. But as we go live, let me go to Nishan Chaturvedi, who's there at the inauguration. Nishan, what are you seeing around you? Tell us a little bit more about the inauguration ceremony as we prepare for Donald Trump to be sworn in as the 45th president of the United States.
Rajdeep, whatever I'm seeing, it's pretty ironic and strange. This is no celebrations. Look at it. These are the protests happening against Donald Trump. Why these protests? Why are you protesting? Excuse me. Why are you protesting?
Because we want to make sure that we can live in a country where we're not under attack every 2 seconds. We want to live in a country where people have health care and housing and jobs and not living under racist attack or anti-LGBT attack. Thank you very much. Have a great day.
Rajdeep, just look at it. We are just about a kilometer away from the Capitol Hill, and this is the protest march just before the swearing in.
Very interesting.
Is definitely not celebration.
Let's see if you can get some more voices for us, Nishan. Try and get some more voices. Very interesting to hear those voices. Can you get us some more?
I'll try to speak to some people. What are the reasons for these protests? He's been elected as the president of America.
We're all furious in all of about all of his policies, no matter what comes of them. He's led up to it. We don't, like Maxine Waters says, we do not respect him because he doesn't respect us as women. He doesn't respect us as immigrants. He doesn't respect anybody who's a person of color. He's got another thing coming.
No, but tell me one thing. He's been elected. The democracy has voted in him. Then what's your problem?
Because it's part of our right to protest when we don't feel like we agree with him.
But do you think the mandate which he's got, he's already having...
I'm not disputing that he was elected or not elected. It's a farce. The whole thing is a farce.
What is farce?
Farce, farcical. It's basically based on lies, based on fooling people about the truths that all of us know every day to day, that we suffer from different oppressions, and we were telling Trump that he better get his act together. That's what it is.
Rajdeep, over to you.
Very interesting, Nishan. Very interesting voices that you're getting for us. And you're actually at a place where protests are taking place. Even as we saw Hillary Clinton there, the defeated Democratic challenger, the nominee, who was smiling broadly there. She's at the inauguration. Pictures there of Donald Trump will be also with us shortly. That's the inauguration about to begin. The family of Donald Trump, among others, coming in. But Smita Sharma, interesting that contrast that we just saw. On the one side, we are seeing the protests that are taking place, and I'm told there are going to be even bigger protests tomorrow. Women's groups are coming out on the street tomorrow. So clearly, Donald Trump's election is taking place under the shadow of controversy, even as we see the family of Donald Trump coming to the inauguration.
Absolutely. Those images that are live streaming right now, Rajdeep, these are the images. We can see Ivanka Trump, Donald's daughter, who in a way humanizes her father's face. along with her husband, Jared Kushner, who, remember, has been appointed as a senior advisor to Donald Trump in the White House. So the family is going to have a key role. But the protests playing out, Rajdeep, in a way, it sends out a message that Donald Trump, at the moment, this inaugural ceremony is really more of a political celebration rather than a celebration of the United States of America. That's the one question that has been asked right from the point when he was elected, whether Donald Trump will be the president of the United States or the divided states of America.
Right.
But somewhere, perhaps, the protesters will have to also take a deep breath because he is, at the end of the day, elected through a fair election process.
Interesting that his son-in-law is going to take such an important role in the Trump administration. Imagine if Robert Vadra was to ever in a Rahul Gandhi administration, if there were ever to be one, if he was to take such a role, the opposition would be up in arms. At the moment in the United States, it appears Donald Trump is setting his own rules clearly, and that includes, as I said, the fact that his son-in-law is going to play a very important role in a new Trump administration as a special advisor. It's the richest cabinet that America has ever had. Most of the Hollywood A-listers, though, have stayed away, interestingly, Smita. Many of them were asked to perform. They've refused to do it. Bruce Springsteen, among others, has refused to perform. So clearly, as you said, this inauguration is taking place amidst a mood of a divided states of America. Are we exaggerating it when we say that? Because you can see the pro-Trump supporters also there. Is this the divided states of America then?
You know, I think there has to be a different approach to this, Rajdeep. You know, the fact is, yes, Donald Trump had a very, very polarizing election campaign, a campaign which almost looked like it was built on hate, on fear. There were serious accusations of racism against Trump, of misogyny against Trump. Having said that, there was, at the end of the day, that entire section that voted for him. And we have seen these protests right from the day of the election results coming in. You know, that majestic view that you see, Rajdeep, we should not forget that D.C., New York, these have traditionally been blue states. But in these protests today, we are not seeing people simply from D.C. There are people who are marching in. This is an important message that Donald Trump must take home, that he has to reach out to all these people who he might have hurt during the election process.
I want to also now go straight across to Beijing because our correspondent in India today is Anand Krishnan is joining me from there. Anand, your sense in Beijing, because obviously we'll be looking very closely at Trump's attempts in a way to take on China in the months ahead. Is Beijing looking at this entire inauguration rather warily? Do they see the Trump presidency creating potential for a U.S.-China standoff?
Well, Rajdeep, that's absolutely right. The phrase that I've been hearing a lot today and yesterday is hope for the best, but prepare for the worst. So that's something that that's a sense we're getting here in Beijing, that there's a lot of concern about the rhetoric from Donald Trump aimed at China, especially on the trade front, where he's threatened imposing as much as 45% tariff on Chinese imports, which would have huge ramifications for Chinese industries. So there's a lot of concern, but on the other hand, there's also a sense that Trump, the president-elect and candidate, might be quite different from Trump, the president. So, of course, we'll have to wait and see whether that's the case or not.
Right. Interesting you're saying that, Anand, but, I mean, do you believe that the Chinese will believe they can do business with Donald Trump in any substantive way? Do they believe, on the other hand, that Trump will target China?
Well, Rajdeep, initially it was interesting that they very much welcomed his election victory as they saw him as somebody who's non-ideological, somebody who's transactional, a businessman they could cut a deal with. So they've been a bit alarmed in the last couple of weeks when you've seen Trump taking a strong stand on South China Sea, on Taiwan. So I think that that optimism has certainly given way. And as you rightly said, wariness is the best way to describe the sentiment in Beijing right now.
Best way to describe the sentiment in Beijing right now. What's the sentiment in Islamabad? As I said, we are going to go across the world here on India Today to give you a sense of what this means to the world. Our correspondents have fanned out across the world. I want to go to Kaswa, who's our correspondent in Islamabad. You tell us, Kaskar, what is the mood in Islamabad? There's a sense that Donald Trump will be particularly tough on terror groups who are based in Pakistan, and thereby will be really turning the screws and the heat on Pakistan. Is there wariness or a fear? Is there fear of a Trump presidency in Pakistan?
Sorry, I cannot hear you because of the distortion in the line. Can you please repeat your question? What are you asking about?
But is there fear? Do they fear a Trump presidency? Okay, he was. Smita, the Pakistanis, is there a fear on the Pakistan side that a Trump presidency is going to be very tough on Pak-based terror groups? And that is the hope that India has, in a sense, that we can do business with Donald Trump. We found in the past democratic administrations have raised issues of human rights, raised issues of Kashmir. On the other hand, Donald Trump has said all the right things so far, at least from an Indian perspective, when it comes to Pakistan.
I would say that there is definitely a sense of nervous anxiety in Pakistan, Rajdeep, because A, the kind of statements that Donald Trump made during his election speech against minority groups, against Islamic terrorism, they were almost controversial. He's a man who, during his election speeches, remember, even advocated waterboarding. He has been all for stricter action against Islamic terror groups. But he has a man, General Mattis, a retired, in fact, commander, a lieutenant general. He has actually had 41 years of experience in the Afghanistan-Pakistan region, and a man who is known for very sharp views. He has led U.S. troops in Afghanistan, in Iraq, even during the Kuwait war. So James Mattis is going to be Donald Trump's key point person in this region. And in a way, he knows Pakistan, which is what bothers Pakistan, because then he also knows their weak points and where they are absolutely creating trouble for the region and the world.
Now, we expect Donald Trump to speak in what, about 45 minutes from now, around 10:30 IST is what we are told. It's not going to be a very long speech, most people believe, about half an hour at best. Nishant, the expectations that people have there in Washington, where you are they expecting Trump to be an Obama-like orator, or do they realize the limitations of Donald Trump when it comes to oratory? Are they expecting what kind of a speech are people expecting today from Donald Trump there, Nishant, in Washington?
Well, going by what he does on Twitter, I'm sure they're not really expecting much out of the speech, but the last speech of Barack Obama was about for 20 minutes. Now, if you go back to many, many years ago when JFK said, don't ask what we can do for you, but you must ask as to what you can do for America. Now, this speech is something which goes into history. So definitely, I mean, if you can recollect, Donald Trump tweeted some days ago a picture when he's saying that I'm writing my inaugural speech. So people are expecting that he's going to talk about work, how he can generate work. People are expecting that he is going to talk on the lines of how he's going to make America great again, which has been his kind of tagline throughout the elections. But when it comes to rhetorics, we have seen a fair bit of Donald Trump on Twitter, and we have seen a fair bit of Donald Trump as to how he talks. So.
Well, Twitter cannot become the basis.
He's able to come out the way.
Sure. Twitter cannot become the basis for an inauguration speech. You mentioned, of course, the famous JFK speech on this day, ironically. The youngest U.S. president, and now you have the oldest U.S. president. And I don't think Donald Trump is John F. Kennedy. He's not probably Barack Obama, too, when it comes to his oratorial skills. But he has a way of connecting with people, which has been his big, which has been one of his big advantages. You can see more images there of the defeated Democratic challenger to Hillary Clinton. And in a way, many believe that Bernie Sanders was the man who could have taken on Donald Trump. And the wife of the Vice President, as you can see, images.
Escorted by the Democratic staff director of the United States Senate Committee on Rules and Administration, Kelly Fado, Ms. Irish Weinshall, and Mr. Paul Pelosi.
First images of the hugely popular Michelle Obama. A lot of applause for the way she has conducted herself for the last 8 years now in the White House. In fact, it's been called the best first family when it's come to their conduct in public life, and a lot of focus there on Michelle Obama. For a moment, I also want to go to London. Lavina Tandon joining us. How is London seeing those images playing out You can see Trump's wife, Ivana Trump, as well. You can see Hillary Clinton, Bill Clinton there, and of course, Michelle Obama, really towering over them, and in many ways has become a great favorite in America. But how do you respond? How are people seeing this there in London, Lavina?
One word, the mood here is cautious hope, Rajdeep. The media has been overwhelmed. Trump has hogged limelight as well as headlines for the past 3 days in UK, and it is happening right now as well. It's a huge event, considering the fact that UK and US have shared a very special relationship, not an official word, but something that everyone has known and feels here in the UK. And this is a very, very phenomenal and a milestone moment for the relationship, because there can't be any, we do not know what to expect of this president. He has no journey that we can see as a politician. All we know him is as a businessman and a tycoon and a man who has run a very polarized campaign and has been eccentric and known to have changed his thoughts. But what is very hopeful here is the fact that this is the man who is not sending Britain at the back of the queue as a result of Brexit. Now that Brexit has happened and he's becoming the president, we are hopeful here. People are hopeful that he will keep his promise and treat Britain fantastically as far as dealing or trade deals are concerned.
Right.
For UK, US is the biggest trade exporter, so it's very, very important. But of course, here in amongst the people and amongst the media, they had almost slandered 80% of media here, and people have slandered Trump for what he had said. There was a campaign run where
Lavina, I'm going to have to
was signed.
I'm going to have to stop you to just get a sense. Smita is telling us who is exactly coming through at the moment. I'm going live to our correspondent in Jeddah also in a moment. But Smita, Trump's family slowly coming in to join the inauguration.
You know, we first saw, of course, the former First Lady Michelle Obama come out with Laura Bush. Hillary Clinton is already there. Then the Obamas, actually, they greeted the Trump family in White House after the Trump family bid goodbye to the Obamas from the White House. You can see, of course, Melania Trump there being, we will see her being escorted out. They're walking basically to the western side of the Capitol, the western front of the Capitol.
I just want to go to Jeddah. I want to go to Jeddah there to a correspondent who's joining us at the moment. Ma'am, give us a sense of how the Arab world at the moment is looking at a Trump presidency. Is there a sense of nervousness as to what a Trump presidency could mean for the various conflicts that have taken place in and around the region?
I can clearly say that there is a nervousness and uncertainty, and the people are clueless. They want to watch him, especially the first 100 days, whatever will be the decisions will be done by Mr. Trump. And at that case, the people will be certain that what he is up to do.
But what is it that they fear most? Is there something they fear of a Trump presidency?
The fear is like that because they have a clue that there will be the no more two you can say the two states solution of the Palestine will not gonna happen. Maybe there is uncertainty about it, but there is a good hopes as well regarding the Iran issue, because we can feel the people in the Arab world, they can feel that the Iran nuclear whatever the deal it is, maybe not be done anymore. It will not be feasible anymore. So maybe there will be the most peace. The people, they are just watching whatever gonna be happen, but they are uncertain and clueless right now.
Uncertain and clueless is the words that you're using in a way to describe the mood in the Arab world. A sense that people are not sure who the real Donald Trump is, and that's part of the problem. He's the 45th president of the United States, and yet there are many who still don't know who the real Donald Trump is. You can see those pictures now coming in. President Obama with U.S. President, with his vice president Joe Biden, whom he gave a Medal of Honor only recently. And that's the outgoing administration in their blue ties, and they'll be replaced by the men in red. And you'll see them in a moment from now. I'm also joined at the moment by former senior diplomat KC Singh, who's a man in pink today because pink is the color of his turban. This ceremony in itself is a celebration of American democracy. the old order changes, yielding place to new. And for all the differences in the talk that Smita said about divided states of America, there is a sense of continuity.
And orderly transition.
Do you see what we just heard? The words we are hearing, we heard from China, from our correspondent in Beijing, the word was wary. Cautious hope was the word in London. Fear was the word in Pakistan. And uncertainty was the word in the Arab world. How do you see, give us a sense of how the world is seeing this event today?
Rajdeep, the problem is that during the electoral process, whether in India or in US, many things are said. But once somebody is elected, generally the president-elect or the prime minister-elect is quiet. He goes about constituting his cabinet, then they appear before the Senate. The focus shifts there. What is the position they are taking during their Senate confirmation? Whereas Mr. Trump has continued his stream of consciousness via his tweets almost on an hourly basis.
That's right.
You know, he's called, in the middle of an election, a looming election in Germany, he's called Chancellor Merkel as having made a serious mistake admitting the refugees. Now, that's a very sensitive issue there. He's interfering in German election. And she's a stabilizing factor, the last stabilizing factor in Europe, who's standing for moderation and the liberal order. Then he tells Prime Minister May in England, you're doing very well to leave EU. And then he says, but NATO itself,
I just told you.
And the Vice President, Joseph R. Biden, escorted by Senate Democratic Secretary Gary Myrick, Senate Democratic Leader and Rules Committee Ranking Member Charles E. Schumer, and House Democratic Leader Nancy Pelosi.
Barack Obama, the ever popular Barack Obama, leaving behind, some would say, a mixed legacy, but many will acknowledge at the end of the day that he has been a reconciler in a way at a difficult time in the United States. Remember, he came, took over his presidency when the economy in particular was struggling. He leaves behind a much stronger economy. And you can see George W. Bush there. So in a sense, you've got the old order and the older order also meeting. So they've, and you've got Bill Clinton there.
And this despite both his parents,
yes.
George Bush Sr.
Yes.
And the mother being admitted to hospital.
That's right.
Because normally you would have seen him. He is the senior most surviving ex-president. So it's nice because this is where they are showing continuity, where political differences, bipartisanship comes to the...
And we'd like to believe that that exists in this country as well. That, you know, you've seen at inaugurations of Indian prime ministers, the opposition also does come. So,
it does.
I mean, maybe the United States does it a little bit more grandly and a little bit more formally. There's a date for it, and it's done with a particular way every time. And there you can see the applause for Barack Obama.
But remember, Rajdeep, only two of his cabinet nominees have been approved.
Right.
Whereas when Barack Obama came in, 7 or 8 had got the approval.
There you have the president-elect. Coming in for the ceremony, you can see some of the other big leaders of the Democrats,
Paul Ryan
among others, coming in. But you've got, in a way, Donald Trump walking on his own and looking like a singular figure that he often is in many ways that reflects the nature of the man.
His sartorial quirk is he never buttons his coat,
right.
And he wears his necktie too long. So I asked somebody, I said, why does he do that? They said he's very conscious of his rotund middle. So, you know, to cover that, normally your necktie is worn up to your belt.
Right.
But you'll find his necktie is a couple of inches longer. And he does not button his jacket. So it almost seems like only he's only wearing an overcoat. And he's not wearing a coat underneath.
I'm going to try and see if Nishant is still there with us outside in Washington, D.C. Remember, Nishant is our correspondent on the spot who's... And one of the few to interview Donald Trump. I wonder whether, Nishant, you ever asked him Why does he keep his coat jacket unbuttoned always? Why doesn't he button up the jacket? Okay, there you have. Let's just play those images. But there is the mystery, of course, of the unbuttoned Trump jacket, as they would call it. But these are just one of the many mysteries of the man.
There was a lot of mystery and questions that used to be raised even about his hair during the election campaign. So people have actually generally been interested in everything
he
does.
Yeah, but what we need to hear is, what is the tone he adopts? Because of the series of tweets that he has been issuing, because of the way he treated CNN during a press conference.
Right. So there you've got Michael Pence, the vice president-elect of the United States. He was seen as a surprise choice at the time, but he did rather well in the vice presidential debates. In fact, many believe that he did much better than Donald Trump himself in the vice presidential debates.
He's actually seen as a stabilizing factor in this administration,
right?
Because he's been a governor, and of course the president doesn't bring really any government experience to the table.
Right.
Which was not, and that's why it was very surprising, because he's taken on the intelligence even before he comes on. And they have what is called the president's daily brief. It's called PDB. Every morning, a one-page summary is put up to the president of the day's intelligence report. And he has said only other president who had a bad relationship with the intelligence was Nixon. Nixon stopped receiving that report. Now, we don't know whether he's going to do likewise.
I also remember, in fact, Mike Pence, during the vice presidential debate, you know, the positions that he took on Russia were much in contradiction to what Donald Trump was saying at that point in time. And a lot of people felt that he wasn't debating to defend actually the presidential candidate of the party, but he was actually eyeing the next presidential race where he might pitch himself as a candidate, Rajdeep.
Right. We should now go across to Amy Casman, bureau chief of the Financial Times. Amy, as someone who perhaps never expected Donald Trump to win, do you believe this is a day of reconciliation? Have you finally reconciled to the idea of Donald Trump as U.S. president?
I mean, myself personally, I don't know. I mean, obviously, he's becoming the president right now as we speak. He'll be taking the oath of office very shortly. But it's clear that America remains a nation that is deeply, deeply divided. Tomorrow there will be major protests in Washington, D.C. and many cities among people that still are finding it very problematic, you know, what he stands for, what he stood for in the election. So I think that America is perhaps more divided than it's ever been on the eve of the inauguration of a new president.
Interesting. I also, for a moment, want to, as we play out those pictures, yes, go ahead, Smita.
You know, Rajdeep, I guess what is very important is that, yes, we are seeing these divisions, that, yes, we are seeing these protests happen, which are considered unprecedented. But we have to remember that one of the reasons why Donald Trump got elected was the fact that a lot of people thought that in being politically incorrect, he was speaking without manipulating his thoughts, which sort of hit a note with a lot of the people who voted for him.
We'll leave it there. Let's listen in to the speech as Donald Trump walks in.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the chairman of the Joint Congressional Committee for Inauguration, the Honorable Roy Blunt.
Thank you all. If you have a seat, you can sit down. Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, Mr. President-elect, Mr. Vice President-elect, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the inauguration of the 45th President of the United States of America. Today, the legislative, the executive, the judicial branches of our constitutional government come together for the 58th inauguration of the President of the United States. Millions of people all over the world will watch and will listen to this event. 36 years ago at his first inauguration, it was also the first inauguration on this side of the Capitol, President Ronald Reagan said that what we do here is both commonplace and miraculous. Commonplace every 4 years since 1789, when President George Washington took this exact same oath. Miraculous because we've done it every 4 years since 1789, and the example it sets for democracies everywhere. Washington believed the inauguration of the second president would be more important than the inauguration of the first. Many people had taken control of a government up until then, but few people had ever turned that control willingly over to anyone else. And as important as the first transfer of power was, many historians believe that the next election was even more important. When in 1801, one group of people, arguably for the first time ever in history, willingly, if not enthusiastically, gave control of the government to people they believed had a dramatically different view of what the government would, should, and could do. After that election that actually discovered a flaw in the Constitution itself, which was remedied by the 12th Amendment, Thomas Jefferson, at that inauguration, beyond the chaos of the election that had just passed, said, "We are all Republicans, we are all Federalists." After 4 years of civil war, Lincoln's second inaugural speech tried to find reason for the continued war when he pointed out that both sides prayed to the same God. He'd earlier written about those fervent prayers that one side must be and both sides may be wrong. But in 1865, he looked to the future, and the memorable moment in that speech was, "With malice toward none and charity for all." In the middle of the Depression, the country was told that the only thing we had to fear was fear itself. And President Kennedy talked about the obligation in democracy to country. The great question that day was, ask what you can do for your country. So we come to this place again, commonplace and miraculous, a national moment of celebration, but not a celebration of victory, a celebration of democracy. And as we begin that celebration, I call on His Eminence Timothy Michael Cardinal Dolan, Reverend Dr. Samuel Rodriguez, and Pastor Paula White Kane to provide readings and the invocation.
The prayer of King Solomon from the Book of Wisdom. Let us pray. God of our ancestors and Lord of mercy, you have made all things, and in your providence have charged us to rule the creatures produced by you, to govern the world in holiness and righteousness, and to render judgment with integrity of heart. Give us wisdom, for we are your servants, weak and short-lived, lacking in comprehension of judgment and of laws. Indeed, though one might be perfect among mortals, if wisdom which comes from you be lacking, we count for nothing. Now with you is wisdom, who knows your will and was there when you made the world, who understands what is pleasing in your eyes, what is conformable with your commands. Send her forth from your holy heavens, from your glorious throne dispatch her, that she may be with us and work with us, that we may grasp what is pleasing to you. For she knows and understands all things, and will guide us prudently in our affairs, and safeguard us by her glory. Amen.
From the Gospel of Matthew, the 5th chapter, God blesses those who are poor and realize their need for him, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. God blesses those who mourn, for they will be comforted. God blesses those who are humble, for they will inherit the earth. God blesses those who hunger and thirst for justice, for they will be satisfied. God blesses those who are merciful, for they will be shown mercy. He blesses those who are pure in heart, for they will see God. God blesses those who work for peace, for they will be called children of God. God blesses those who are persecuted for doing right, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. And God blesses you when people mock you and persecute you and lie about you and say all sorts of evil things against you because you are my followers. For you are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on its stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, that everyone will praise your Heavenly Father. Respectfully, in Jesus' name.
We come to you, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, with grateful hearts, thanking you for this great country that you have decreed to your people. We acknowledge we are a blessed nation with a rich history of faith and fortitude, with a future that is filled with promise and purpose. We recognize that every good and every perfect gift comes from you, and the United States of America is your gift, for which we proclaim our gratitude. As a nation, we now pray for our president, Donald John Trump, Vice President Michael Richard Pence, and their families. We ask that you would bestow upon our president the wisdom necessary to lead this great nation, the grace to unify us, and the strength to stand for what is honorable and right in your sight. In Proverbs 21:1, you instruct us that our leader's heart is in your hands. Gracious God, reveal unto our president the ability to know the will, your will, the confidence to lead us in justice and righteousness, and the compassion to yield to our better angels. While we know there are many challenges before us, in every generation you have provided the strength and power to become that blessed nation. Guide us in discernment, Lord, and give us that strength to persevere and thrive. Now bind and heal our wounds and divisions, and join our nation to your purpose. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. The psalmist declared, let your favor be upon this one nation under God. Let these United States of America be that beacon of hope to all people and nations under your dominion, a true hope for humankind. Glory to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Missouri State University Chorale.
Strangers welcome,
Well, the Missouri State University chorale practices and performs about two blocks from my home in Springfield, Missouri, so it was easy to find them, and we're pleased they're here. It's also a great opportunity for me to introduce my colleague, the Senator from New York, Chuck Schumer.
My fellow Americans, we live in a challenging and tumultuous time, a quickly evolving, ever more interconnected world, a rapidly changing economy that benefits too few while leaving too many behind, a fractured media, a politics frequently consumed by rancor. We face threats, foreign and domestic. In such times, faith in our government, our institutions, and even our country can erode. Despite these challenges, I stand here today confident in this great country for one reason, you, the American people. We Americans have always been a forward-looking, problem-solving, optimistic, patriotic, and decent people. Whatever our race, religion, sexual orientation, gender identity, whether we are immigrant or native-born, whether we live with disabilities or do not, in wealth or in poverty, we are all exceptional in our commonly held yet fierce devotion to our country, and in our willingness to sacrifice our time, energy, and even our lives to making it a more perfect union. Today we celebrate one of democracy's core attributes, the peaceful transfer of power. And every day we stand up for core democratic principles enshrined in the Constitution. The rule of law, equal protection for all under law, the freedom of speech, press, religion, that the things that make America, America. And we can gain strength from reading our history and listening to the voices of average Americans. They always save us in times of strife. One such American was Major Sullivan Ballew. On July 14, 1861, when the North and South were lining up for their first battle, a time when our country was bitterly divided and faith in the future of our country was at a nadir, Major Ballew of the 2nd Rhode Island Volunteers penned a letter to his wife, Sarah. It is one of the greatest letters in American history. It shows the strength and courage of the average American. Allow me to read some of his words, which echo through the ages. My very dear Sarah, he wrote, the indications are very strong that we shall move in a few days, perhaps tomorrow. If it is necessary that I should fall on the battlefield for my country, I am ready. I have no misgivings about or lack of confidence in the cause in which I am engaged. And my courage does not halt or falter. I know how strongly American civilization now leans upon the triumph of the government, and how great a debt we owe to those who went before us through the blood and suffering of the Revolution. And I am willing, perfectly willing, to lay down all my joys in this life to help maintain this government and to pay that debt. Sarah, my love for you is deathless. It seems to bind me to you with the mighty cables that nothing but omnipotence can break. And yet, my love of country comes over me like a strong wind and bears me irresistibly on with all these chains to the battlefield. Sullivan Ballew gave his life on the battlefield a week later at the first battle of Bull Run. It is because Sullivan Ballew and countless others believed in something bigger than themselves and were willing to sacrifice for it that we stand today in the full blessings of liberty in the greatest country on earth. And that spirit lives on in each of us, Americans whose families have been here for generations and those who have just arrived. And I know our best days are yet to come. I urge all Americans to read Ballew's full letter. His words give me solace, strength. I hope they will give you the same. Now, please stand while the Associate Justice of the Supreme Court, Clarence Thomas, administers the oath of office to the Vice President of the United States.
Place your hand on the Bible. Please read. The Bible.
Vice President-elect, would you raise your right hand and repeat after me? I, Michael Richard Pence, do solemnly swear.
I, Michael Richard Pence, do solemnly swear
that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office on which I'm about to enter.
The duties of the office on which I am about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, accompanied by the President's own United States Marine Band.
Yeah.
an honor to introduce the Chief Justice of the United States, John G. Roberts, Jr., who will administer the presidential oath of office. Everyone, please stand.
Please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, Donald John Trump, do solemnly swear.
I, Donald John Trump, do solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully execute.
That I will faithfully execute.
The office of President of the United States.
The office of President of the United States.
And will, to the best of my ability.
And will, to the best of my ability.
Preserve, protect, and defend.
Preserve, protect, and defend
the Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, Mr. President.
What a great honor to be able to introduce for the first time ever anywhere the 45th President of the United States of America, Donald J. Trump.
Did I get that one right?
Chief Justice Roberts, President Carter, President Clinton, President Bush, President Obama, fellow Americans, and people of the world, thank you. We, the citizens of America, are now joined in a great national effort to rebuild our country and restore its promise for all of our people. Together, we will determine the course of America and the world for many, many years to come. We will face challenges. We will confront hardships. But we will get the job done. Every 4 years, we gather on these steps to carry out the orderly and peaceful transfer of power. And we are grateful to President Obama and First Lady Michelle Obama for his aid throughout this transition. They have been magnificent. Thank you. Today's ceremony, however, has very special meaning. Because today, we are not merely transferring power from one administration to another, or from one party to another, but we are transferring power from Washington, D.C., and giving it back to you, the people. For too long, a small group in our nation's capital has reaped the rewards of government while the people have borne the cost.
Washington flourished, but the people did not share in its wealth. Politicians prospered, but the jobs left and the factories closed. The establishment protected itself, but not the citizens of our country. Their victories have not been your victories. Their triumphs have not been your triumphs. And while they celebrated in our nation's capital, there was little to celebrate for struggling families all across our land. That all changes, starting right here and right now, because this moment is your moment. It belongs to you. It belongs to everyone gathered here today and everyone watching all across America. This is your day, this is your celebration, and this, the United States of America, is your country. What truly matters is not which party controls our government, but whether our government is controlled by the people. January 20th, 2017 will be remembered as the day the people became the rulers of this nation again. The forgotten men and women of our country will be forgotten no longer. Everyone is listening to you now. You came by the tens of millions to become part of a historic movement, the likes of which the world has never seen before. At the center of this movement is a crucial conviction that a nation exists to serve its citizens. Americans want great schools for their children, safe neighborhoods for their families, and good jobs for themselves. These are just and reasonable demands of righteous people and a righteous public. But for too many of our citizens, a different reality exists. Mothers and children trapped in poverty in our inner cities. Rusted out factories scattered like tombstones across the landscape of our nation. An education system flush with cash, but which leaves our young and beautiful students deprived of all knowledge. And the crime and the gangs and the drugs that have stolen too many lives and robbed our country of so much unrealized potential. This American carnage stops right here and stops right now. We are one nation. And their pain is our pain. Their dreams are our dreams, and their success will be our success. We share one heart, one home, and one glorious destiny. The oath of office I take today is an oath of allegiance to all Americans. For many decades, we've enriched foreign industry at the expense of American industry, subsidized the armies of other countries while allowing for the very sad depletion of our military. We've defended other nations' borders while refusing to defend our own. And spent trillions and trillions of dollars overseas, while America's infrastructure has fallen into disrepair and decay. We've made other countries rich, while the wealth, strength, and confidence of our country has dissipated over the horizon. One by one, the factories shuttered and left our shores, with not even a thought about the millions and millions of American workers that were left behind. The wealth of our middle class has been ripped from their homes and then redistributed all across the world. But that is the past, and now we are looking only to the future. We assembled here today are issuing a new decree to be heard in every city, in every foreign capital, and in every hall of power. From this day forward, a new vision will govern our land. From this day forward, it's going to be only America first. America first. Every decision on trade, on taxes, on immigration, on foreign affairs will be made to benefit American workers and American families. We must protect our borders from the ravages of other countries making our products, stealing our companies, and destroying our jobs. Protection will lead to great prosperity and strength. I will fight for you with every breath in my body, and I will never, ever let you down. America will start winning again, winning like never before. We will bring back our jobs. We will bring back our borders. We will bring back our wealth. And we will bring back our dreams. We will build new roads and highways and bridges and airports and tunnels and railways all across our wonderful nation. We will get our people off of welfare and back to work, rebuilding our country with American hands and American labor. We will follow two simple rules: buy American and hire American. We will seek friendship and goodwill with the nations of the world. But we do so with the understanding that it is the right of all nations to put their own interests first. We do not seek to impose our way of life on anyone, but rather to let it shine as an example. We will shine for everyone to follow. We will reinforce old alliances and form new ones and unite the civilized world against radical Islamic terrorism, which we will eradicate completely from the face of the earth. At the bedrock of our politics will be a total allegiance to the United States of America, and through our loyalty to our country, we will rediscover our loyalty to each other. When you open your heart to patriotism, there is no room for prejudice. The Bible tells us how good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. We must speak our minds openly, debate our disagreements honestly, but always pursue solidarity. When America is united, America is totally unstoppable. There should be no fear. We are protected, and we will always be protected. We will be protected by the great men and women of our military and law enforcement. And most importantly, we will be protected by God. Finally, we must think big and dream even bigger. In America, we understand that a nation is only living as long as it is striving. We will no longer accept politicians who are all talk and no action, constantly complaining but never doing anything about it. The time for empty talk is over. Now arrives the hour of action. Do not allow anyone to tell you that it cannot be done. No challenge can match the heart and fight and spirit of America. We will not fail. Our country will thrive and prosper again. We stand at the birth of a new millennium, ready to unlock the mysteries of space, to free the Earth from the miseries of disease, and to harness the energies, industries, and technologies of tomorrow. A new national pride will stir our souls, lift our sights, and heal our divisions. It's time to remember that old wisdom our soldiers will never forget. That whether we are black or brown or white, we all bleed the same red blood of patriots. We all enjoy the same glorious freedoms, and we all salute the same great American flag. And whether a child is born in the urban sprawl of Detroit or the windswept plains of Nebraska, they look up at the same night sky, they fill their heart with the same dreams, and they are infused with the breath of life by the same Almighty Creator. So to all Americans in every city, near and far, small and large, from mountain to mountain, from ocean to ocean, hear these words. You will never be ignored again. Your voice, your hopes, and your dreams will define our American destiny. And your courage and goodness and love will forever guide us along the way. Together, we will make America strong again. We will make America wealthy again. We will make America proud again. We will make America safe again. And yes, together, we will make America great again. Thank you, God bless you, and God bless America. Thank you. God bless America.
So there you have it, Donald Trump speaking for about half an hour, his first speech as the President of the United States, a speech that resonated with two words, America first, a speech in a sense that has set the agenda for the Trump presidency, a presidency that promises to put America and Americans first, to live the American dream and dream big, as Donald Trump called it.